Do you have any direction you want to take this? Because, you know, to keep it fresh and keep it different from what we did last time, do you have any ideas?
Not really. I'm not really approaching it from a particular angle. I think it'd just be interesting to get us talking about what we see, you know?
Sure.
And maybe not to dwell on things that we've dwelled on in the previous one. We talked a bit about rules, but I knew that you wanted to maybe clarify something about that. is that true, or should we just press play and see where it takes us?
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to, you know, for instance, Robbie Cahill, who's, you know, considered to be a great player, who's to me mediocre. He dances a jig every time he gets the disc in his hand. I'm going to make that part of the telecast because,
yeah, sure.
You know, it's the biggest reason why the game hasn't evolved. It's a false positive when someone's doing something illegal and the commentators are sitting there applauding him for being a great player. And, you know, it's like, there's no way of, you have to have a way, in any competition to have balance and, you know, and so for me, the reason that the game has not evolved, and it's very complicated, but a large part of it is the false positives, and most of those come from the fact that there's no penalties, and and nobody seems to have the standards are ridiculous.
That could stem from, I mean, because I see it as a kind of training and strategy route that means that everything that the teams do is kind of backwards, and you know they're always going into the teeth of the defense, and they're set up like the formation and stuff is just all based around ridiculous ideas in the first place, and because the whole game is then played in that manner, then people are always going to be positive about some stuff and negative about some stuff, and so the false positives, sure, you know, they're people have been positive about stuff that is like wrong or whatever, but they don't have the example of what's right, you know. So long as,
well, let me interrupt. In fact, we should almost, are you recording this?
I am, yeah, but
that's good.
Yeah,
a false positive is when a child puts their hand on a burning stove and it smells like petunias and it doesn't hurt. That's a false positive. Something that should be inflicting pain, so they know not to do it again. And instead of inflicting pain, it smells like a rose garden. They're getting a sensory input. Oh, I did something good, when in fact they didn't. And so if someone travels and beats the marker and throws a 50-yard huck for a score to a defender, I mean, to a receiver who pushes off the defender. So they're both false positives on both ends. They think that's a good offense.
Yeah.
And so that's a false positive.
Yeah. at the same time, people get pretty protective about what they know and love. So if you're offering a critical view without a, you know, productive kind of alternative, then people react badly to it. It's a general psychology thing. So it's difficult in the ultimate kind of world that we live in, where you know everything is kind of going in or everything has gone in that one direction for ages, without that alternative even being visible, really. Then people, yeah, get defensive when kind of they get criticized without understanding what the alternative is. Should we hit play and see what happens with the?
Sure, footage? Sure. Let's okay, just so see what happens. All right, on my mark, 3, 2, 1, go. I can turn my audio down.
Cool.
That's too bad. I wanted to talk about the.
Who's in white? Is this Sockeye in white?
Sockeye's in white. Boy, that's horribly boring.
Is that a false positive? I mean, that was just a long throw. I mean, it's a pretty accurate long throw.
It's a false positive for one thing, the 25 or 20 yard, oh yeah, it's Danny Karlinski, then it's definitely a false positive, and that's a travel. Yeah, it's a false positive. And let's make the end zones, I got an idea, let's make them 10 feet. Okay, watch his feet. One, two.
Yeah. You couldn't really see, it's obscured by someone's head.
It's if nothing else, it's horribly boring. Like, who cares?
I quite liked the catch. You know, he got both hands to it. He wasn't leaning forward. He kind of jumped and got his hips close to the disc to make it good coordination and stuff. The defense, it seemed like Revolver had someone kind of poaching in the lane, I think it's called, where he had the force, and then he had someone just stood a few yards off, waving their arms.
Yeah, I didn't see that. Unfortunately, we lack the technology to do this remotely. I'm in North Carolina, and you're in England somewhere, so we're doing the best we can. It would be nice to do slow motion and do rewind and have it all synchronized so we can do this together. All
right. So,
this is classic ultimate. Watch every catch. He does the one thing. Here we go. Every receiver catches the disc. And there you go. You get a result. The result there is a turnover.
I actually really liked the spread of the Revolver players there.
A spread formation is a great thing, no doubt. But when every time you catch a disc, you turn and you pivot away from, you pivot into the defense and away from the strength of your offense. Every player does it. Just look at this. Catch, look downfield.
Yeah.
Watch this.
And it kills the disc, doesn't it? Because the flow stops.
It's the stupidest thing you can do. I mean, you couldn't do anything more stupider than that. Look, you catch the disc, look downfield. Not only does it kill the disc, but the amount of work, catch the disc, look field, and you have, boring, long catch. It kills the disc, but if you just look at the amount of effort, if you can calculate in terms of calories or exertion or the amount of force, the other six players on your team are doing as a result of you doing this really stupid move, and you multiply that by 8 or 6 or 7 or whatever games it is over a weekend, it's retarded. Catch the disc, look downfield. And yay, this is horribly boring. And a push-off foul. That's Bo Kittredge. He's supposed to be one of the best players in the world. He just clobbered someone. I mean, this is a joke.
He fell over.
Hmm?
He fell over. Yeah, that's 50-50.
Wait. Yeah.
That's 50-50, and then he fell over.
Well, he fell over. He pushed off. The defender pushed off. Who pushed off whom? It's a little nutty that you've got a sport where there's no remediation for, contact that happens. And yeah, sometimes it's accidental, but no players really try to avoid contact because it's not in the rules. So they don't, and I don't think anybody intentionally does it, but they also intentionally don't do it.
I think plenty of players try to avoid contact. I think there'd be a lot more contact if people didn't.
That's fair, but there's a lot of players who just don't. I don't know why the play just stopped. That was kind of ridiculous. Catch the disc, look downfield. And you look at the amount of work.
When you're saying catch the disc and look downfield, you've got to look at the alternative. So when they make these passes, the person that just passed to them is normally free if they just run straight away from their defender, right, to get another pass back.
Almost, if you look on that one, it's that Reed Cost back there. I like Reed. He's a good friend of mine. Almost every time the person who threw the disc is wide open. It's a free throw. If you just watch this.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay, see, that guy's wide open.
Yeah.
And again, there's a turnover there. He had the guy wide open. Instead of throwing to the guy right in front of him, right in front of his eyes, in a position where he catch the disc, look downfield.
Yeah, he could have thrown it to the guy on the line and then
watch this. When he catches the disc, that guy's wide open. But it shouldn't be just that. That's what we have right now because that's what this team's running. But you should have 2 to 3 people wide open. And then what you're going to find, so if he catches the disc right there and throws back to the thrower, that thrower then is going to have 3 or 4 people wide open right in front of him. Another turnover there. I mean, these are supposed to be the best teams in the world. How many turnovers are there so far? About 5 in this game? This is a joke. So you see what I'm saying there? Like, if he catches a disc, throws back to the thrower, and now that thrower is looking downfield.
That was a timeout, I think. But that was odd. So that last throw there, he threw to the guy right next to him and then just put his head down and just ran, like, jogged kind of, like, further downfield towards the end zone. Whereas those two players were in loads of space, so they could have just worked it up together until a defender had to bite in to stop it. But there's this mentality of not only when you have the disc in your hands, you turn and phase upfield to try and or downfield to try and make a pass, but also when you pass the disc off, if you're not like a handler, then you pass the disc off and then you just clear and you just get your head down and you just run towards the opposing team's end zone. And that goes against kind of like any kind of flow or anything.
Well, and the funny thing is, it's all about semantics and definitions. Yeah, you know, if you definitely. Just change the idea of clearing started around 1987, 1988, and it is truly brainless, terminally brain dead, as I like to say. But that's what you're describing, where the person, and this became a nomenclature, became part of the culture. Oh, you throw the disc and clear. And a spread is, like most things in Ultra, very virally, and it became part of the game. Oh, well, naturally, that's what I'm supposed to do. I threw it, and I'm supposed to clear. And again, it's one of the dumbest things you can do. And the other thing that you said, which is a nomenclature or a semantic thing, is that you defined a person as a handler. This is ultimate frisbee. Every player on the field is a handler. That's what the rules are. There's a ridiculous throw. And what's Reed doing? I mean, you guys just had a cluster. I can't say it. There may be children listening to this. And he's acting like that was a great score. Look at this. Watch this horrible throw and the travel. It's a ridiculous throw and a lucky catch. Watch Reed react to the score. Whoopty frickin' dude. I mean, that's something to be proud of. This is a national. There's a huge travel there. How is that even fun?
He's deliberately leading that disc over to the left, which is the break side, hoping that the defenders will kind of get stuck under it. But, you know, they did have a bid on it. So, you know, it did end up being pretty low percentage kind of shot. So, yeah, I'd agree. It wasn't a great player by any stretch of the imagination.
So back to what I was saying, and I've got this great vertical. I have a horizontal weave drill. It's on my website, and but I've developed a 5-man vertical weave where nobody's clearing, everybody's cycling in and out, and everybody on the field's a handler. You know, again, this is the national championships. This is the offensive line for a revolver here. Every guy I'm looking at, I know most of these guys. They're all handlers. So to think that someone's going to catch the disc and clear because, you know, at this particular point in time, he's been designated as a cutter, which again is a ridiculous. I don't know when the word cutter started because that's a relatively new thing.
Yeah.
It's about 10, 15 years old, and that's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Everybody's a handler, and everyone should know the offense. Everyone should be able to play every position in the offense. He pushed off and a travel.
Yeah, it's a limiting thing.
It's limiting, exactly. And it's just the only thing that makes it limiting is the definition.
And it seems to be more and more prevalent, you know, like when you attend trials for a team, now you have to specify if you're a handler or a cutter. Even on the rosters for this game, they had
There's only two. It's ridiculous. I'm sure you've seen diagrams of my offense. I've got 5 positions. 2 of them are duplicates. There's 2 forwards and 2 shooting guards, I believe. Have just 2 positions on a 7, but if you look at it, it's the way things get defined in the culture that's really limiting.
It's because you're not, if you're, I mean, when you go into roles like that, you're so that's another 50-50 cash. When you go into roles like that, then sure, like you might be able to perform higher on like a and if you've got a like very limited amount of training time, you know, because you're learning very like set things and you're just learning your role. But really, if you want to be the best team possible, then every player can do everything, because, you know, if you're quote marks a handler and the defender kind of thinks, oh, this guy's a handler, I'm gonna stop him getting the disc, if you're able to then burn downfield and you know, catch a hug or even, you know, cut back and start playing the role of a cutter all of a sudden, and then that'll throw the defender off. They don't know what to expect. And vice versa with someone who traditionally is a cutter, you know, if they then fall into the traditional handler role halfway through a point, then they become unguardable, because, you know, the defender can't stop the player getting the disc in his hands near the disc and in the end zone. You know, they have to give something up.
Well, that, but
I don't think the structures that we play in really
catch the
really
disc, turn downfield, and the travel. Zach Karlinski again.
At the moment, the structures we play in, like the 3-4, you know, are kind of more geared towards having those set roles.
I think a bigger, better question is why is it that, you know, why doesn't Boston have, you know, five different positions, and Sockeye have two, and Seattle have three, and, you know, why is it that every team in the world, this is to me more of a, you know, a systemic issue with the culture and the game. Why isn't there any diversification in the different strategies that every team in the world has only two positions? That's like, it makes no sense. What other sport has, I guess soccer you can say, well, but you've got what, four different positions in soccer?
Yeah, I think it's because people feel more comfortable when things are defined. And
sure, that's great, but why not have...
Because, I mean, the formations aren't evolved enough, you know. The vertical stack has got two handlers, right? The guy with the disc and the guy behind him. And then the horizontal's got three handlers. Everyone else is pretty much in the same role. And traditional horizontal stacks, you know, the players move from the middle to the side, so you can't really have, you know, wing players and central players. But, you know, I'm agreeing with you. There should be more positions.
There's a huge travel. Two travels. He just traveled twice. I don't know who that guy is.
And, so horizontal stack was brought in like 2000, was it? Was it by Sockeye or by Furious? It was around time.
No. Nothing's ever been brought in by these top teams. You know, it's always been
popularized. Maybe is the word.
Yeah, popularized would be a better way of saying it. But these teams don't innovate; they never need to. You know, Sockeye just, our Revolver just won the national championship. Do you think they're going to go come up with a new offense for next year? No. But yeah, horizontal started, but horizontal was just a fallback.
I disagree with that. I think the top teams do that. I've heard at you know, top team trainings before that if you don't innovate, then you stagnate. You know, so they do try and stay ahead of the game, and you know, that does benefit them. I don't think a team will say, you know, oh, we won nationals with this setup last year, so therefore we're going to win again this year. You know, they're more wily than that. But you know, I don't think that top team would risk running something so different. You know, like that the offenses they're going to run are going to have been tested and tried to a certain level already. You know, like, so Revolver's side stack, obviously they didn't innovate it, but they were probably one of the first ones to bring it to the like absolute top stage. You know, some team has to be the first to bring something to the top stage.
Right.
But it had already been, you know, played and tried and tested for several years. So
I think getting back to the game here, and this is really, I think, something that just should be the biggest emphasis is, you know, the stuff you've been experimenting with, stuff I've been trying to promote, is not nearly the alternative that we're presenting, both you and I, is something that's, I don't know, perhaps, without sounding hyperbolic, an order of magnitude more efficient, which means over a weekend, you know, these teams who are catching the disc, running upfield, being athletic, are working 10 times harder in total on offense. You know, there's no flow. Every time they catch the disc, they have to start all over trying to establish flow, but they're not really even trying to establish it. So yeah. There's no leverage. There's no maintaining any leverage that they got because they don't even try to make any gains on leverage.
Yeah. The sustainability of the offense is limited. I think it stems from a American football kind of approach where it is pass, and then reset, and then pass and reset the offense, rather than passing into a position where there's already a option for a continuation kind of thing, which you see more in soccer. You know, every player has the ball, has got the players already set up around them to provide the options.
Well, like Revolver, I'd love to coach these guys. They already do have the people in positions. They just don't. I mean, they're not that far away from running a proper offense here.
And Sockeye have great flow as well at times.
Karlinski catches the disc, pivots upfield. He's got two guys. He had two guys, one to the right and left, right in front of him, catch the disc, look upfield. This is Caldwell.
Both teams using fakes to good effect. Well, no one really cut on the break side for Caldwell after he faked his mark to the floor, but the last score was generated from fakes by Eli.
But you're absolutely right about the football thing, and I'm not sure if you'd read the full interview with Irv Kalb, who basically invented this game, but it's fascinating to me that Irv was, way before he codified and formalized the rules for Ultimate, had been playing, and he was a 19-year-old kid. I mean, people need to understand this. But he had been playing a ton of touch football at the time. And so the entire rules were based on football. I mean, the thinking that he went into the rules. Why is it legal to run out of bounds? Well, because a catch was made. His whole game is ultimate is based on one thing in Irv's mind, is that turnovers could only happen during a throw. So once a throw was completed, a turnover can happen. So you can go out of bounds and reset, just like football. I asked him, why is it that you can't hit the disc out of the thrower's hands? And I was expecting because it's too aggro or too violent or... And his answer was, no, it's none of those things. The reason you can't hit the disc out of the thrower's hands is because the disc basically isn't in play. A turnover could only happen during a pass. And that sounds really bizarre, and it actually is. But the funny thing is that his basic mentality of ultimate being football-based or play-based, like American football, you have four downs, and you've got four downs to move the line of scrimmage 10 yards, and once you accomplish that, then you get another first down.
Yeah.
Ultimate is also downs based. This can't be overstated enough. Ultimate is downs based, except to get another set of first downs, all you need to do is throw a completion.
Yeah.
And you only get one down to throw a completion. And that might sound like I'm splitting hairs, but I'm not. The whole game is based on this. And so the way people play, coincidentally, is very much like Irv wanted, which is a football game. You watch this, and it's exactly what he had envisioned 45 years ago. Catch the disc, okay, the play's dead. The disc is not in play. The disc is not in play.
Well, I guess the rules stemmed from that, for sure. And a lot of strategy is also stemmed from the American football kind of side of things. But I think we're fortunate that the rules don't state that you have to
catch Cassidy Rasmussen. I played goalie with this kid when he was 15 or something, a lot in Santa Cruz. That was an amazing catch. I talked to the guy. I think that was Ashlyn who threw that, who admits it was a crappy throw. And here's some people are saying, oh, this should be on Sports Center top 10, blah blah blah. It was a piece of crap throw. Amazing catch, no doubt. I like Cassidy. He used to play a lot with
him. Do you think he would have caught it the same way if he was left-handed?
No.
I mean, yeah, maybe.
I mean, I would have caught that left-handed.
Yeah, if you got perfect ambidexterity, then yeah, potentially left hand, because then, you know, it's coming into your hand, stopping the momentum. But then it could come down to footfalls, you know. Depends which foot you're taken off of, you know, and which way your body can twist. Either way,
no, it's a hell of a trailing edge.
Either
catch,
way, yeah, either way, you did.
But it was, a crap throw. Anyway, back to what we were saying.
I was in the middle of saying,
Go ahead.
Although it might all stem from kind of American football and the rules might, but the rules are open enough so that actually a totally different style of play is possible.
So, well, no, absolutely. What I'm proposing here is that the strategies evolved more out of the rules or out of Irv's intention than they did out of American football per se. Karlinski, catch the disc, pivot upfield. I mean, that guy who's got the disc now, who that is, was wide open the whole time. Karlinski just traveled.
So the thing that I've noticed about Sockeye's offense, I'm not interested in this, they surround the disc quite a lot, which means that the defenders sag off and stop that throw that they're looking for. So they catch the disc, look upfield, or downfield, whichever you want to call it, and then the defenders appear from the size to then limit those options. We've seen like a few discs like squeeze through next to defenders. And I think if they didn't surround the disc and if they passed, when they passed forward and when they centered the disc, if the people on the sides pushed up so that then everyone was then in front of the disc, then they would limit the options to the defenders to cause issues. But it would also mean that passing straight back to those players that passed them the disc would be more positive kind of moves. You see what I mean?
No, absolutely. You're absolutely right. And you know what? The question I have is: you look at Murray just caught a score there, and it was very. It was a little push off there.
Debatable. He definitely knew what he was doing with his body positioning.
Well, it was another throw.
Yeah. Well. Yeah.
Karlinski just traveled three times in a row. But the question is when what you're saying gets figured out, when people understand the implications of what you're saying, and this game gets, they understand how easy this game, does Murray actually get excited for catching a score here? I mean, this game is incredibly easy once you stop making it so hard. And these teams are making this game 10 times harder than it needs to be. By looking off by clearing downfield after a throw, by cutting downfield or pivoting downfield every time they catch the disc.
I think offense can be made much, much easier, but I think that when it is, then defense will evolve as well. And I don't think defense has even been given like a chance to or like hasn't had the necessity to evolve, you know, so different defenses come up, but the offense hasn't evolved. I don't think the defense has been forced to evolve.
Defenses have evolved, but they're not being deployed. There was a travel. Was that my friend Robbie Cahill? Cahill's 10. So the most sophisticated D I've seen out there is matchup zone, which is man-on-man with a ton of switching. And that works best against the kind of offenses you and I run. And it works better than zone and better than man on motion offenses.
Yeah, that's basically what Flexicon defense is as well. The best principles from zone and from man.
No, what'd you call it? Flex?
Yeah, Flexicon.
Flexicon?
Yeah, because it's a 2-3-2. Type thing, where you're not strictly in your zonal position. You know, you're encouraged to switch if appropriate.
Right.
But you're also encouraged not to switch if appropriate.
We used to call it flex defense too. and once you start doing flexes or whatever, you know, there's different variations of it. I hate the idea of a junk defense. I think that's just it's the biggest misnomer. It's the best defense. Cahill with a travel and the score.
What do you mean by junk? Because I think it means different things in US to UK.
Well, junk is... I think junk is a word that's used to apply to any kind of defense that's not zone and not man-on-man. And so you got a lot of different types of flex formations with lots of switching. Some of it's very flat-footed where people are just standing around. And that certainly isn't. I mean, matchup zone is you're running hard on defense all the time, but you're switching, early and often. And to me, that's the best defense. If you're standing around, unless it's really windy, you're gonna get by a good team.
Yeah, defense. You should be putting in all your energy, mentally and physically, to even stand a hope of getting a turnover against a good team.
But back to what you were saying, yes, evolving defenses will help. You give me, give me Revolver, Sockeye, whatever, Ring of Fire for 6 months, and there's not a defense in the world that'll stop them. I mean, look, offenses look the way these guys catch. They catch the disc, look downfield. The stall count, I have this statistic I like. I actually should talk about some of my stats here because they're all very useful. One of my favorites is average time of possession. How long is it in your hands in average? And according to me, your average should be around 1,000 milliseconds, 1 second, and that's not too much to ask, especially if you can throw a bunch of them that are less than a half second.
That's a nice throw.
Yeah, Scuba's amazing. The way it's come to the forefront. So many good players use it now.
Yeah, it's more just the angles he had available with the force and the poach, and then the other defender involved. There wasn't many throws that would have safely avoided all those defenders, but then that Scuba was perfect for the situation.
So average time of possession on this point by Sockeye was actually pretty low. It's probably close to a second and a half, which is pretty awesome from what I've seen. But if you imagine if your average time of possession is 3 seconds, 4 seconds for a whole tournament, and you multiply that by the total number of cuts and effort and work required by the other six players in your team while you're holding onto the disc for 4 seconds, 5 seconds every time you've got the disc, you're making the game way harder than it needs to be. I mean, these guys are all studs, and they need to be because their offense is so dumb.
So I've looked at this from perspective of playing other games as well, and there's basically fighting skills and positioning involved in other games that I've played, in computer games in particular. But the fighting skills seems to be what Ultimate teams are winning on at the moment. You have the studs, you have the side stack where you isolate a big player on the other side of the field, and then they've got all the space, and it's a one-on-one fight. Yeah. And obviously offense has the advantage, so they win that fight, and then they catch the disc, and then the next person steps in to have a one-on-one fight. Yeah, so
it's been this way for decades. There's been no... And it's because of this, I think, when a 55-year-old man comes out there and starts talking shit, like saying, look, I'm unstoppable, I can play against any of you, they can't believe it because their whole paradigm is based on fighting skills. And they're like, well, how can you be a good fighter? You're 55 years old. It's like, I'm not a fighter. What was the other category you used? Fighting and what?
Positioning was what I used. So,
if you're a gamer, I would use fighting versus...
What else is there? It's like resource control and...
Well, I would say no, but more in the sense just the cerebral part of the game.
Yeah.
You know, the craftiness, the chess match, the game within the game. You're using leverage, you're using your mind, you're using... Looked like a little travel there.
Sure. The positional stuff you can talk macro in whole like formations, but you can also talk micro. Because, you know, even with the best fighting skills in a game, if you're not thinking about the second-to-second positional advantage, then, you know, you're going to have to work a lot harder than you need to. And so there's the very simple positional advantages you have in Ultimate, you know, where you cut away from the defender rather than trying to get past them. And then there's the bigger positional situations, which is more like formations and stuff. And I don't think that people have really looked into that in Ultimate or excelled at a high level with that. And I think it's all been very much focused on fighting skills. And sometimes teams have kind of got lucky in a way with positional things, but I don't think the theory of positioning has really been explored.
Yeah, I would. So I'll agree with your definition and you know, put that under my, you know, cerebral part of the game. And so that's all I do is positional. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm a decent fighter. I was, you know, God gifted me with a nice physique, but my game, especially the last, you know, couple decades, has all been about positioning. You know, how do you gain an advantage? How do you apply leverage? How do you maintain that leverage? And this is why I don't find a single player in the game worth watching, because there's nothing, none of that going on at all. There's nothing interesting to watch. Sure, Cassidy Rasmussen just made this ridiculously amazing trailing edge catch. That's a nice part of the game. But in sports, unless it's track and field, there's the other part of the game that you're talking about. And even track and field, you can have some amount of positioning. You know, if it's a relay race or whatever, there's some sense of that strategy. There's very little of it here, and it needs to be explored.
So you see Sockeye again surrounding the disc. You know, when the disc was bricked, you had the two players on the side dropping back behind him, which meant that when the throw went to those players, there was no immediate continuation because he's passing the disc backwards away from the rest of his team. Which meant that, you know, he looks up field as he does, and then there's a good 20-25 yards until there's another player. Whereas if those players push forward a bit, they'd be just as hard to guard, and when they got the disc, there'd be an immediate continuation available.
Karlinski with the travel. Yeah, and that shouldn't be rewarded right there. Oh, he got up and God, that's so ugly. I mean, the rules really don't facilitate what you're calling positioning.
How so? Surely you can. The rules say you can stand wherever you want. I mean, netball rules.
No. You're from the standpoint of excellence. You know, excellence in your approach to the game and. You know, the mental acuity when you apply to the game and try to defeat your opponent, when you've got a framework that's predicated on really soft, forgiving boundaries, take as many steps as you need to stop. Sidelines really isn't out of bounds. I mean, that guy just laid out for a catch. If you think about that, just completely objectively in a sports way, okay, we're at the moment he's on the ground, he's come to a stop, he's got to pivot. It's almost impossible for a player to forget the rules of Ultimate for a second. The guy's lying on the ground, he's got to pivot. It's probably his knees, it could be his hips, but he's established a pivot. He should not be allowed to stand up. So that player just laid out for a catch. In Ultimate, if you're throwing and your receiver has to lay out, it's a shit throw. I mean, bottom line. You know, if you're making your guy get down on the floor, it's not a good throw. It shouldn't be rewarded by allowing him to get up. And that player got up and then committed another traveling. That's not promoting excellence. That's not promoting a position where you need to, you know, evolve your positional acumen.
Yeah, there's no continuity,
become an excellent
is there?
Player. Not raising the bar high enough.
It's the same, like, pass and then reset kind of situation, isn't it? Like, that pass is completed, so let's put it behind us and move on. But if the pass was poor, you know, and a layout was needed, then you're saying that then the next throw should technically really be harder because that pass wasn't up to scratch. And so
why not?
The continuity means that then...
Right. So it forces you, A, as a thrower, it's incumbent on you as a thrower to make sure you don't put your player on the floor. that's reasonable. That's going to increase your acumen and your positioning and your intelligence. You know, people talk about basketball IQ. And when you're talking about position, you're talking about ultimate IQ. And to say that the game right now is all fighting and no positioning is saying that the ultimate IQ of every player we're watching is extremely low. And that's basically what I've been saying for 20 years. You know, they're not really doing anything very clever.
Yeah, but they're doing
cleverness. Like, yeah. Where's the cleverness?
It comes with experience, though. And maybe because it's a young sport, there aren't huge numbers of people who stick around watching
it. You know, Mike Payne's their coach. I played with Mike, and I played against him. You know,
I'm not saying everybody gains that insight. But, you know, as the sport's growing, I think more and more people are going to start looking at it that way. And the players, what the players are doing here, it's probably no different to what we were doing in our first 10 years of playing.
Players, to me, in the 1980s were a lot more clever than this. In fact, I don't even want to qualify that. That's just a fact. And, you know, players were way more clever in the 80s.
Is that due to a more open style of coaching? You know, like the false positives, you say, may have encouraged then people to teach ultimate in specific ways. This is why we have the handlers and cutters and stuff. People are told that they're handled, they're told that they're cutters, they're told what that role is, they're told what they should do. Whereas maybe back in the 80s, there was a lot more people kind of figuring it out for themselves. Is that fair?
Yeah, I talked to Idris Nolan, who was coach of captain. I don't know if they had coaches, but he was in charge of JAM 10 years ago. And I was, you know, JAM was running Plinko, which was basically my offense, although they didn't know how to do it properly. But they had Toaster and Seth Blatcher, a couple pretty decent point guard type players who, you know, those two guys were very clever and they learned on their own, you know, like what you're saying. They weren't really told, hey, this is how you do it. And I think it's really complicated Mike Payne certainly... You know, Mike Payne's not, he was a mediocre player. He's not the kind of guy who can orchestrate how a point guard should be moving on the field. He couldn't do that at all. But anyway, back to Idris, you know, I went and met with him and we were talking about this stuff. And he basically said, Frank, look, I don't disagree with anything you're saying. There's no way in hell I'm teaching my players how to play this. In other words, he was saying, I have to teach them something so dumb and so stupid and so simple that they can execute. Anything beyond basic, catch the disc, pivot, throw to somebody else, which is, you know, not very intelligent at all, is too complicated and sophisticated. He's like, look, we're dealing with a bunch of egos here. It's hard enough coaching these guys as it is. If we just distill it down to the basics and tell them, look, just do this, then we can win a national championship, and they did.
Yeah, I mean, it's a fair point. I coach at university, you know, so I've got like 3 years with every player, pretty much, and I have to consider, you know, what level of advancement, or what kind of advanced level do I want to teach for offense and defense, that they're going to be able to get the highest performance after 2 years or 3 years. So it is a constant thing to consider. And I think as the sport grows, and especially as it extends into schools, then we're going to see intelligent ideas about offense.
I'd like to think so. But, I mean, the sport in less than 18 months is going to be 50 years old. You know, Joel Silver, you know, the basics of it were invented in 1967. You know, and by 40 years ago, certainly, you know, there was the game had gotten formalized and there was teams playing everywhere. And by the 80s, you know, there were that it had evolved to the organizational, at least, perspective where there was, you know, wow.
I think the defender got a piece of that or a foul, maybe. Yeah.
But again, he's throwing right through the defender instead of running. I mean, that just wasn't a clever play at all. There was nothing clever about this. I don't know. I hope you're right. I hope this changes. It doesn't help that you've got rosters of 27 people. That doesn't inspire cleverness.
I think the important thing is for people to be open-minded about the possibility that something is better, you know? Because if they're not, then they're going to go into schools being like, this is the way to do it. This is what, you know, this is what the top teams do, therefore this is the best thing. Whereas if people realize that actually there's a possibility that the teams that are performing the best aren't actually, you know, employing the best strategies and such, that then that opens up the possibility for it to improve and to go from level to level when it gets introduced, like, on a wider scale into schools and such.
Well, so how, speaking, you know, to that point, how have you found success? Let me rephrase that, because that could be misinterpreted. What I'm saying is you're riding the cutting edge. You're trying to some of these different ideas. And what's needed, according to what you're saying, is for you to win something major, and then people will take notice. Of course, they're like, oh wow, look at what this guy's doing. So have you, you know, how far away from you from achieving some sort of accomplishment where people can look at what you're doing and saying, oh wow, here's an alternative that actually is working because this guy's winning tournaments.
Well, I think with Brighton, who I'm in the position that I've been the main coach for up until last year for about maybe 10 years, and in the last few years I've introduced the new ideas, introduced those ideas to the uni students that go on to play for the club team, but we've maintained a very high level, even though we've completely changed our entire roster and our entire style, and we finished third in the UK behind Clapham and Chevron just a month or two ago. And like I said before, it's not necessarily the first team that does it is going to be the one that finds, you know, the gold medals and success with it. But if you can prove that it's possible, and you know, and it's something that does work, then the top teams that are looking to innovate, then they will look and be like, oh, actually, this makes sense, and then they'll adopt it. Like I said, Revolver won last year with Sidestack, but they weren't the ones to invent it. They just saw another team who did fairly well with it and said, yeah, that could work for us.
Yeah, it's to me, Robbie Cahill, I just traveled 3 times. I mean, that. Where's the cleverness there? The cleverness is, oh, let's see how much I can push the envelope with the rules and cheat and get away with it. That's state-of-the-art cleverness. You know, you need referees. That guy dances a jig every time he catches a disc. You know, the side stack for Revolver was not an innovation. It's a minor tweak.
It's the same. It's the same idea, basically, as the other offenses.
Yeah, let's move players around on the field in a different place.
Yeah,
but you know, the players are still cookie cutter. You don't have, you know, they all do the same thing when they catch the disc. They catch the disc, pivot upfield. There's nothing different about their style of play, their tactics or strategies. They may have moved a player here or there to open up space, but it's not. It's a minor tweak. It's not an innovation.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that's something that I've heard people on the sidelines at UK. Yeah, we'll wrap this up because maybe do the second half another time. I've heard players on the sideline in the UK say that, you know, Brighton play in a style which is unlike anyone else's, you know, because we do move the disc quickly and don't have resets, and it's a completely different style which players are coming through now, and that's all that they've learned. So it continues to evolve with those players at the cutting edge, and you know, and we're still able to perform at a very high level. So I think, you know, players in the UK who see that are starting to recognise that you know, it can work as well as the other traditional offences.
Well, what they need to see, as well as, isn't good enough.
It's a start.
What people need to see is this works better than the conventional.
Yeah,
but if it's as good as, then there's no reason to switch.
People seeing that and people believing that is a different thing. People won't recognize that if they see it. Do you see what I mean? Whereas if say Clapham adopted Hexagon offense and then they won nationals with it, then suddenly then everyone would be like, oh look, it works better, you know. So it's what actually works better and what people believe works better are not always the same thing.
I did a lot in the early 90s when I had my core team. We go to tournament with 10 people and we would play point for point with every team and nobody could understand it because it was, you can imagine, I'm not sure what it's like for you, but for me back then, to get people to try something different, I didn't get the cream of the crop. Let's be clear about that, you know? So yeah. I would go to a tournament with a bunch of scrubs in Frank and play every team for point for point. And they were people, and it was everything you're saying. Oh, it's this offense. You know, in that sense, it was very successful because people are like, wait, he doesn't have any studs. He's only got 10 players. He's competing against teams with 25. And he's playing for point with everyone, this offense. And yet it still didn't, you know, it didn't, no one picked up on it.
Okay, let's wrap it up. It's been nice chatting to you again, Frank. I'll get this.
We'll do it again, same place, same time next year.
Indeed.